As we've gone over before in covering the seals, the trumpets, and the vials in the book of Revelation, there is a setup before the actual spiritual death takes place at the sixth seal, the sixth trumpet, and the sixth vial, involving the four hidden dynasties and the formulation of the one-world political system, the first beast of Revelation chapter 13 that does not emerge until the woe of the fifth trumpet. It's then wounded to death, and that's what the fifth vial is, and then we go from 555 to 666, which is when Satan appears as the false Christ in Jerusalem, after which the true Christ returns at 777, the seventh vial, the seventh trumpet, and within the time frame of the seventh seal. But in the first four vials, you're going to see the globalization of each of the four hidden dynasties, beginning with education, then economics, politics, then religion, with what's actually being written of not occurring until the sixth trumpet. And what I want to draw your attention to are the semicolons that you'll find in Revelation 16. That's what separates the initial setup from the ultimate actuality. And beginning with verse 1, with the word of wisdom from our Father, in Jesus' name it reads, "And I heard a great voice out of the temple saying to the seven angels, go your ways and pour out the vials of the wrath of God upon the earth." Verse 2, "And the first went and poured out his vial upon the earth." Semicolon. Now this was in 1830, but what you read after this doesn't happen until the sixth trumpet, the sixth seal, and the sixth vial. It can't happen until then because there isn't a mark of the beast until Satan appears as the false Christ. That's when they receive that mark of the beast in their forehead or in their right hand, which is the deception that Jesus has returned, and they'll die spiritually at that time. With Christians being the only group who can die spiritually, this vial is specifically poured out upon Christianity with the rapture theory of 1830, when a mentally ill teenage Scottish girl was ground zero of this first plague, the any moment doctrine, because if Christianity believes that Christ will return at any moment, and most Christians believe that Christ will return at any moment, they're going to worship the false Christ, because Satan appears as the false Christ before the true Christ returns. So the first went, the first angel, and poured out his vial upon the earth, semicolon, "And there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the men which had the mark of the beast," and this can't happen until the sixth trumpet, the sixth vial, and the sixth seal, "and upon them which worshipped his image," the image of the beast, an image of Satan being transmitted throughout the world via the modern day technology. They'll worship him via satellite. That's the image that they're going to worship. Remember, Satan exalts himself above all that is called God or worshipped, as you can read in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. So then obviously this image, the image of the beast, is an image of Satan. Verse 3, the second vial now, "The second angel poured out his vial upon the sea," semicolon. And in the setup, as far as the hidden dynasties are concerned, the four hidden dynasties, we have here the hidden dynasty of economics in 1913 with the implementation of the Federal Reserve System, with the sea being symbolic of peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues, as we know from Revelation 17, verse 15. And after the semicolon is when you see the result, which transpires at the sixth trumpet. "And it became as the blood of a dead man," speaking of the spiritual death, "and every living soul died in the sea," with two-thirds of the population being spiritually dead already, and the remaining third being Christian. Every living soul dies in the sea at the sixth seal, the sixth trumpet, and the sixth vial, whenever Satan appears as Antichrist. The semicolons here are very important in understanding the seven vials. A semicolon is a punctuation mark indicating a pause, typically between two main clauses, that is more pronounced than that indicated by a comma. Again, a punctuation mark is what a semicolon is, indicating a pause, typically between two main clauses. Verse 4, "And the third angel poured out his vial upon the rivers and fountains of waters," semicolon, "and they became blood." When? At the sixth trumpet. "And I heard the angel of the waters say, Thou art righteous, O Lord, which art and wast and shalt be, because thou hast judged thus. For they have shed the blood of saints and prophets, and thou hast given them blood to drink, for they are worthy. And I heard another out of the altar say, Even so, Lord God Almighty, true and righteous are thy judgments. This third vial lining up with the hidden dynasty of politics. And right after the Federal Reserve was globalized in 1913, you had the First World War, which was really the first global event of all time. After that First World War, you had the Bolshevik Revolution and the birth of the Soviet Union. After the Second World War, you had the birth of the United Nations. And the United Nations will obviously provide the skeletal structure of that one world political system that you can read of in Revelation 13, with the League of Nations, the precursor to the United Nations, providing the skeletal structure for the United Nations. The He-Goat that you can read of in Daniel chapter 8 is that Kenite nation, but notice its feet don't touch the ground. It's not geographic necessarily. It's a one world shadow government formulating the one world system that will not emerge until the woe of the fifth trumpet. With that great horn of the He-Goat being the United Nations, who sends out a raiser of taxes, possibly speaking of the carbon tax there, as you've heard of recently, I'm sure. Another unprecedented event, a global tax, first time ever as far as that's concerned, and apparently that just identifies the Great Horn as being the United Nations. That horn is broken, meaning it segues directly into the one world political system that you can read of in Revelation 13 as well as Daniel 7. With Daniel's fourth beast being the supernatural. So there will not be a one world political system until Satan and his angels are cast out of heaven unto the earth. Daniel's fourth beast. And the fourth angel poured out his vial upon the sun, symbolic of the truth, semicolon, and power was given unto him to scorch men with fire. And this doesn't happen until the elect are delivered up during the sixth trumpet, at which time the Holy Spirit speaks through them. At that same time, you'll have the two witnesses prophesying. And as it's written in Revelation chapter 11, verse 5, And if any man will hurt them, fire, that's the truth, proceedeth out of their mouth and devoureth their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. And returning to Revelation 16, and verse 9, And men were scorched with great heat, that's the truth, because they're deceived at the sixth trumpet, because they think that Jesus has returned, and blaspheme the name of God, which had power over these plagues, and they repented not to give him glory. Now backing up to verse 8, And the fourth angel poured out his vial upon the sun, semicolon, that was 1948 when the final generation began. That's the positive as far as the elect and the two witnesses are concerned, being the children of light as opposed to the children of darkness. The Kenites and their co-religionists with that year 1948 having to do with them as well in the negative sense of 1948. And in the fourth trumpet, in Revelation chapter 8, verse 12, you see the fourth angel sounded, that's the fourth trumpet, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars. So as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. So not only do you have the generation of the fig tree beginning in 1948, but this looks forward to the death of that third, and leading up to the sixth seal, the sixth trumpet, and the sixth vial, a third are Christian, and that's the only light of the world to be seen. As deceived as they are already, they do still have eternal life abiding within them. That's the light of the world. So this third that die spiritually at the sixth trumpet because they'll be deceived into thinking that Jesus has returned thanks to the rapture theory and the various other deceptions, mainly from not studying their Father's Word chapter by chapter and verse by verse, but they were the only light of the world. The third part of the sun, the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars. The rest of that, the other two-thirds, was already dark because the other two-thirds are already dead spiritually. That's the darkness in the spiritual sense of the word. And if you continue to read the final verse of Revelation chapter 8, And I beheld and heard an eagle, is what this should say, not angel, but eagle, flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, Woe, 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 to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels which are yet to sound. The woe of the fifth trumpet, the woe of the sixth trumpet, and the woe of the seventh trumpet is what this is in reference to. With this fifth trumpet beginning to sound in 1969, but five is grace in biblical numerics. And why do I say 1969? We just read of the moon, and here we see the eagle. The eagle has landed. Remember what happened in 1969, that unprecedented event? And if you continue to read up into chapter 9 and verse 11, you'll see Apollyon, one of Satan's names, in verse 11, Apollo 11 in 1969. But the woe of the fifth trumpet is yet future. Five is grace in biblical numerics, and as we know from Revelation chapter 7, the servants of God must be sealed in their foreheads before the four winds can be let loose. The four winds always mean the five-month-long hour of temptation, which will not begin until the woe of the fifth trumpet, whenever Satan and his angels are cast out of heaven unto the earth. That's when that one-world political system emerges, and then this happens. Back to Revelation 16 and verse 10, "And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seat of the beast," semicolon. Now this is the deadly wound, what we just read, because there is no seat of the beast until that one world political system emerges at the woe of the fifth trumpet, as you can see in Revelation 13 and verse 2, where it says, "The dragon gave him his power," gave the political beast his power, "and his seat," that's the seat of the beast, "and great authority." So what do we have after the semicolon here? After it says the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seat of the beast, that's the deadly wound. So what happens next has to occur during the sixth trumpet. "And his kingdom was full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues for pain, and blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and repented not of their deeds." Being slain spiritually at that time causes complete darkness throughout the world, because again, let's go back to Revelation chapter 8, and the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, that third being the only light, the other two-thirds was already darkened because they're dead spiritually already. This is speaking symbolically. "And the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars." So as the third part of them was darkened, with the other two-thirds already being darkened because they're dead already, spiritually speaking, because they're not Christians. "And the day shall not for a third part of it, and the night likewise." So that third that's still shining, that still has light to it, goes dark after the deadly wound, because that's when Satan appears as the false Christ, as we're about to see in verse 12. "And the sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river Euphrates," semicolon, but since this is the sixth vial, it goes directly into what's described here, as well as everything we just read of, and everything we read in the trumpets concerning that third. The third dies spiritually at this time, in the middle of the five-month-long hour of temptation. "And the water thereof was dried up, that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared." This is when those four angels which were bound in the great river Euphrates are let loose. And the symbolism there is that this is when the seals, trumpets, and vials take on their ultimate spiritual fulfillment. The first six, that is to say, we have yet to get to the seventh vial, which is the return of the true Christ. "And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet." Satan's unholy trinity there, with the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet, as opposed to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Satan has a counterfeit for everything, attempting to copy God. But it's a cheap fabric imitation, not even close. "For they are the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world," the entire globe, "to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty." And Christ interjects here in verse 15, listen to this, "Behold, I come as a thief." When does a thief come? When you're not expecting him. "Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame." And when that third dies spiritually, they'll lose all their credit for their righteous acts that make up their fine linen that they wear in heaven, being made naked, going from being the virgin bride of Christ to the whore of Babylon, Babylon meaning confusion. "And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon." And the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, semicolon, Satan being the prince of the power of the air. This is the true Christ returning and the brightness of his coming, destroying Satan's role of Antichrist as well as his one world system. And this is when the Battle of Armageddon as well as the Battle of the Valley of Haman Gog transpire. Two different battles, both fought by God with the hailstones we're about to read of in a moment. And there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, "It is done." You also see "it is done" written in Ezekiel chapter 39 concerning the Battle of the Valley of Haman Gog. So here you have both battles, Armageddon and Haman Gog, that take place at the end of the 5 month long hour of temptation when all flesh is done away with. And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake, such as was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. And you can read of this in Revelation chapter 11 as well, in the seventh trumpet, because this is the exact same instant in time. And the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell. And great Babylon, which means confusion, came in remembrance before God, to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. And every island fled away, and the mountains were not found, all nations being destroyed, with Christ's kingdom being set up at that time, as we know from Daniel chapter 2, as well as Daniel chapter 7. And there fell upon men a great hail out of heaven, every stone about the weight of a talent, that's about 180 pounds, falling on the head of those who hate our heavenly Father. And men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, for the plague thereof was exceeding great. So there you have it. The main point of this was to point out the semicolons in the book of Revelation chapter 16. A semicolon being a punctuation mark indicating a pause typically between two main clauses that is more pronounced than that indicated by a comma. And just because that third die at the sixth trumpet doesn't mean they can't come out of the confusion, and I think many will because of what God will say through his election during that time.